I will reach. call it suddenly?
Suddenly, you got it.
Still we are the voice.
the fields are as white in your world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord.
So in a couple of weeks, there will not be a service here at Living Way. I will be away that particular weekend. Fortunately enough, there will be a Christmas presentation or a Christmas special that will be happening at Bible Way. And I'm speaking with Sister Grant during the week. She's basically said, you know, if Living Way can make it up again, just as you did for the ANC, that would be great. And I know it will be a great presentation with a lot of the, not only the young children, but the youth are doing a good concert slash play. So it's always an eventful thing. Sometimes I'm in it, as you can see it. I like to, you know, mess about, right? You've seen that now. But I'm not in it this year, but I still believe it's going to be a great and awesome time. So again, if you can make it, that'll be again December the 10th, that's in a couple of weeks, that there will be service again, not here, but in Bible Way in Ottawa. Amen?
Amen.
Other than that, I believe that's the only thing that I've got in mind in terms of an announcement. Again, haven't, just to give you a quick update, but haven't heard again from the landlord, but I think I've got a bit of time this week to sort of make some calls and see where we're at in that regards with this place. And it's always great to have lovely surprises like this market, but you know, like I wasn't expecting, maybe you guys were to some extent. I don't know if it happens yearly or what have you, but okay, so anyway, it's a good to see them, but as I said, it'd also be great to see them in this place rather than around this place. Amen. So, but I'm giving thanks for all things. All right, so with that being said, we will do tithes and offerings, and Brother Ken, if I can get you to pray for tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
I heard that.
It was a lot.
I will get into our word today. Actually, it's funny because the word actually came as I was driving, well, not driving home, when I got home on Wednesday night. It was like from Monday to Wednesday. I don't even think I thought about the word, to be honest. I just said, you know, it's going to come to me, you know, like, you know, God will give me something. So I wasn't stressing or anything like that. And by Wednesday night, I had gotten home. I had gotten a message from Tim in regards to his car and, you know, not having one. I think the motor blew or something like that, so unfortunately. But anyway, got his message and then received a message from me, and I'm sure it was earlier on, but anyway, the message just unable to make it because of, you know, Benjamin's in charge. I think I had mentioned that before earlier, you know, I said, you guys might be here today, but, you know, I said Benjamin's in charge, and so so what came to me at that time was just, you know, saying to me, yeah, like in my head, I was saying, he makes a difference, you know, in your schedule, right, in terms of, you know, you think you're going to do this, but, you know, he can make a difference. And then, right at the side of me was... right at the side of my TV, so I have my TV's right here, at the side of it, I have sort of a bookshelf and it has a couple of things, and lo and behold, it's there, you know how you have something and you don't really look at it all the time? So as I looked at it, there's a written thing that says, make a real difference. And I was like, okay, what are you saying, Lord? You know, they're just talking about the difference, and then it was like right after, I just saw make a real difference. And I was like, okay, what are you saying, Lord? You know, and so I kind of slept on it, and then I just said, okay, you know, give me something, Lord, if you're making this a connection. And then sure enough, in the morning, it was like, boom, he just gave it to me, and I said, all right, thank you, Lord. You know, just like, that's just how it rolls sometimes. So that's basically what I've entitled this message today, Make a Real Difference. Make a real difference. Amen? And so we're going to stand for the reading of the word. First part will be in Acts chapter 6, verse 1 to 7. Acts chapter 6, verse 1 to 7. And it reads as follows. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, everybody say multiplied?
Multiplied.
There arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them, and said, It is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to pray and to the ministry of the word. And the same pleased the whole multitude. And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. And they chose Philip and Prochorus and Nicanor and Timon and Parmenas and Nicholas, a proselyte of the Antioch, whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. And the word of God increased, and the number of disciples multiplied. Is it multiplied?
Multiplied.
It multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. And a great company of the priests were obedient to their faith. Amen. Let's pray this for our heads. Lord Almighty God, I pray, Almighty God, right now, that this word, O Lord God, that you have fed me, O Lord God, becomes food, O Lord God, and substance, O Lord God, to the congregation today. I pray, Lord Almighty God, it will give us nourishment, Almighty God. It will give us, O Lord God, a word, O Lord God, that will bless us, O Lord God, encourage us, O Lord God, strengthen us as we walk this walk, O Lord God, a Christian walk, O Lord God. I pray, Almighty God, that ears be open today, O Lord God, to hear your word, Almighty God, and their hearts open, O God, to receive it. May each and every one be blessed, O Lord God. Use this vessel, Lord, that I can be, O Lord God, to them, Almighty God, a blessing. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. And everybody says,
Amen.
You may be seated. Make a real difference. Imagine for it to be the first thing mentioned in this book that is proof enough to me of how serious the problem had to be. There's a problem of food distribution. This was the issue, and it reared its ugly head inside the church. Before that, everything was seemingly going well in the church. For the church was multiplying. If we look back, we can see in Acts 1, for example, before Jesus ascended to heaven, he tells his apostles, which at the time there was 11 of them, in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it says, But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And ye shall be witness unto me both in Jerusalem, and in Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. In other words, to the ends of the earth. And there, when that was spoken, there was about 120 believers. 120 believers. And at the time, they had to nominate and choose another apostle, of whom they chose Matthias to replace Judas, who had betrayed Jesus. In Acts 2, verse 38 to 42, it says, Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exult, saying, Save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continually steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And so the church was growing, it was multiplying. Now it was 3,000 souls. Now they were multiplying. Amen? And then we see in Acts 3 and Acts 4 a continuation. But in Acts 4 in particular, there's an emphasis on the Apostle Peter and John. They heal the lame and they preach God's mercy and grace. And in Acts 4, verse 4, it says, Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. Again, we're seeing the multiplication of the Christian walk. Amen? And so in Acts 5, verse 14 and 16, we're seeing that by the hands of the apostles, with their signs and their wonders that they're being able to do, we see in verse 14 it says, And the believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes, both of men and women, insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. There came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks, and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed every one. So again, we see that there is more added to the Lord. There is multitudes of both men and women. They were growing. The church was growing. It just means that there was believers, true believers, in this walk. Even to the point, as it said in verse 15, that they brought the sick to the streets, laid them on beds and couches. And I love this. It says, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by overshadowed some of them. That's how much faith they had. That's how much there was an increase of the multitude. Amen? The church was growing. Of course, there was external problems or external issues, meaning that the people that were against the church. There was external issues, meaning that the counselors who saw Peter and John would arrest them. But even then, they couldn't arrest them for long because they didn't really have anything that they could say that they did that was wrong. And they had the multitude were basically coming towards the jails and saying, we want Peter and John out. And so the councils, the external people of the church, the councils, they basically had taken Peter and John and they flogged them, meaning that they beat them. But what did Peter and John do? When they left, they rejoiced. They rejoiced that they were flogged because they said that people were noticing that they were walking for Christ. Amen? And so the multitude just kept on growing and growing. They rejoiced because they were flogged. And so it's noted that the Grecians, the Greek, and the Hebrews in chapter 6, were fighting amongst themselves. This was internal now. For the first time, we're seeing that there were problems within the church. Of course, when I say physical, or they're fighting, that it wasn't physical, but they were fighting by murmuring and complaining. There were rumblings of discontent. Those who spoke only Greek complained that their widows were being discriminated against, that they were not being given as much food in the daily distribution as the widows were who were Hebrew. And so it got so bad that the 12 apostles had to step in and call a meeting of all the believers to try and settle this dispute, the dispute that starts in Acts chapter 6. But truly, all the 12 disciples, or sorry, the apostles, wanted to do was spend time in prayer, spend time in preaching and teaching the good news about Jesus. Amen? They wanted to focus on the Word of God. Amen? When your leader wants to just focus on the Word of God, that's a good thing. That means that they want to just concentrate on the Word and be able to deliver the Word to you. So I'm grateful that in this church, I'm able to do that. Yes, I have a 9-to-5, but every time I get a chance, I'm trying to look at the Word of God to deliver a word, a message to you. And so I'm grateful that I have my apostles. I'm grateful that I have my disciples in this church that are doing those extra little things for the church, around the church. We see the signs outside. We see the backup for AV. Amen? We see that, you know, the music. We didn't miss a beat. Amen? We might miss the song, but we didn't miss a beat. Amen? I go into the washroom. The washroom is always clean. There's always, you know, some semblance of, or not, I shouldn't say always, but there's always some semblance, when I say it always, the word comes out of my mouth, but there's food that we can always see sometimes. Amen? So I'm appreciative. What I'm trying to say is I'm appreciative of all of you that serve. Amen? And you give back to your church so that I can just concentrate, come in here and concentrate on the word. When I come in, Kevin or Brother Eric are praying around here so I can just come in and deliver the word of God. This is what these apostles wanted to do for the church. They wanted to see it grow. And so they just wanted to pray, preach, and teach the word of God. Amen? So they decided to have a plan. How could they resolve this issue of food distribution? And so the apostles came up with an idea that the people, the believers, should choose 7 men. Not just 7 ordinary men, but 7 wise and spirit-filled men that would be seen as good leaders to oversee the food distribution. Amen? Making a real difference. And so we saw again in Acts 6, verse 7, it said, once they made that decision, once they were able to get these 7 new people to take care of this distribution, it says in Acts 6, verse 7, it says, and the word of God increased. Praise the Lord. The word of God increased, and the number of disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. So we see that this issue, this internal issue in church, was resolved, and then they were able to increase and able to multiply. Now, I'll stop there just for a second, just to also mention that if ever we or you individually, as a group, or husband, wife, whatever the case may be, that you see an issue that is before you that you believe is either an issue or it's something that just hits your heart, this door is always open. Even when it's closed, it is always open. Trust me when I say that. I'm always here for you. So whether open or closed, it's open. It means it's open. It means that you can talk to me at any time. I'm telling you that there is no issue. I'm not saying that anybody's come up with anything. I'm just letting you know that it's always going to be open. Amen? Because I want to see this church multiply. I want it to see it grow. Amen? Amen. And so, there was, other than this food distribution, there was no issues with the church. But it wasn't until Acts chapter 8 that we see the real church issues. In Acts chapter 8, verse 1 to 16, I'll read first, and it says, "And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house, and hailing men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word, just as Jesus had said." And in verse 5, it says, "Then Philip," you remember he was one of those that were chosen, says, "Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies, and that were lame were healed. And there was a great joy in that city. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery, and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one." So people believed in the sorcery and believed in this man, Simon. Verse 10, "To whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, This man is the great power of God. And to him they had regard, because that of long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. But when they believed Philip, preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip, and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done, making a real difference. Now when the apostles, which were at Jerusalem, heard what was happening in Samaria, and had received the word of God, they sent unto them the apostle Peter and John, who, when they had come down, prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid their hands on them, and they did receive the Holy Ghost." Amen. But I can tell you, the reality is that, and it's not that it's not impossible, but the reality is that most of you will not be preaching to a multitude. I'm not expecting, even myself at work, when there's a meeting about, let's say, child tax benefits, or CRA, child tax benefits, that all of a sudden I'm going to change things around and say, "Guys, I want to bring the word of God to you." As I said, it's not impossible, but I'm not expecting to do that. Neither am I expecting Brother Fran and Sister Maureen to be on the ninth hole and wait for a multitude of people coming trying to play golf, and there you are preaching the Word of God. Amen. I'm not saying this is not impossible, but I'm not expecting you to preach to the multitude that way. Neither would I be expecting Brother Eric pumping his muscles in the gym. They're blasting music, and then he turns it off and says, "Okay, guys, gather around. I've got a word of God for you." It would be beautiful to see that, but I'm not expecting it that you be preaching the word of God in the gym. As I said, nothing's impossible, but it's something where I'm just saying the multitude, when I talk about the multitude, that is not an expectation. Or Sister Laurel, again, with your craft and community, imagine just saying, "Okay, guys, stop your crafts right now. I'm going to preach the word of God. Everybody take heed, take listen." Amen? Again, not impossible, but I'm just not expecting it. Or Brother Kevin, beautiful Brother Kevin, going up on his hill, wherever he goes, and takes some time to pray for the city, that a multitude would follow him. Amen? That he would just preach to them. Again, I'm not saying it's not impossible. You get me? I'm not saying it's not impossible, but the expectation of a multitude is a big thing. Amen? It's a big thing to tackle. But what I am saying to you is, how do you make a real difference? The real difference in people's lives is usually a one-on-one interaction. Amen? Someone that you are familiar with, that you come into contact with. So that could be your relative, that could be a friend at work, or a friend, someone that you see, that could be a neighbor, someone in your neighborhood, that could be the postman as you walk by, or as you have a relationship with him or her. Simple things that making a real difference comes usually with a one-on-one interaction than it would be a multitude of people. Amen? So many people that we come into contact with, that we have that one-on-one interaction. And sometimes it takes time. I'll give you a great example of one of my friends that yesterday we had celebrated, his name is Brent, and we had celebrated himself, his wife, and his daughter. They had a little gathering together. Well, little was over 60 people, I think. But in that gathering, we got together to just celebrate them because they're leaving to go to England as of December the 10th. And they're leaving for, you know, a good 5 years, at least. They've got a contract there, and it will probably be extended to another, you know, at least 10 years. So they're moving away from Canada. This is a person who I met. He was one of the first people that I met when I came from England to Canada, as he came from Texas to Canada. And we were both in a grade three, basically looking at each other, talking to each other in our accents. And we were like, "What about these Canadians? Like, funny accents." But we got together, we understood each other, and we became friends ever since. And so in that, I have always had a relationship with him. And I was telling you, those were here last week when we were talking about when we had our testimony time, I was telling you that I've been in church since probably 1999. And once I got a hold, or once God got a hold of me, I wanted to share that with my friends. Amen? And so he was one of them. And we used to take trips, going to Europe, going to Jamaica, going to different places. And I would bring my Bible. And each morning he would see that I would just read my word. And, you know, at night I'd read my word and I'd have prayer. And ask him when we had supper, "Do you mind if I have St. Grace?" And he didn't mind. And, you know, so he saw the evolution, I would say, of how I was with my relationship with God. And I can tell you that I didn't push it on him, But I just told him, you know, you need Jesus. Amen? And it formed that relationship. And I can tell you also that once he did accept Christ, which was about 4 or 5 years ago now, that he is now going to church, committed to it. He goes to a church in the East End of town, lives in the East End, goes to the East End. But then he's got his wife that wasn't a Christian or wasn't, following, is now following. He's got his daughter that goes to Sunday school. And this has trickled down in his family. Amen. And so it just took that one-on-one relationship that now I can see the fruit of it. Not just him, but also his family and people that are surrounding. So all I'm saying is that you can make a real difference with one person. Amen? There's one person that you can talk with. I said, a neighbor, a relative that, you might have good interaction with. Sometimes you just have that conversation with them. That's all it is. It's just a conversation. And you can trust in God to do great miracles and wonders. But it's in you. It's in all of us. It's in all of us that we have the Holy Spirit in us to be able to share the Word of God. Amen? And so, in this Word God has given me, He showed me all of this. But then He showed me, in particular, starting from verse 26 of chapter 8. And it says, "And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip." Remember, he was with the multitude, but the angel of the Lord spake to Philip, saying, "Arise and go toward the south unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza," which is the desert. So here he was in the city with the multitude, and God was telling him to go now to the desert. "And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, there we go, I wonder why I was stuck on that one, who had the charge of all her treasure, and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariots, reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him, and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, Understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, How can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this: He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this? Of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water, and the eunuch said, See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he was baptized. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
He was baptized. One-on-one relationship that he had with him, he was able to have, to get him to believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God and to be baptized. This was a one-on-one relationship. He made a real difference. The reason why I keep on saying real is because we can make a difference in people's lives, you know, by being nice to them, you know, like inviting them over for supper, you know, have relationships with them in that accord. But the real difference is when we give them Christ, when we show them what life is all about. Praise the Lord. What life is all about. It's about Christ, Jesus Christ. Amen? And now we can share Jesus Christ. We can share what God can give them. Amen. We can share the salvation.
Amen.
This is what it's all about. It's all about to honor God. And how do we honor God? That we, as us humans, can have that interaction, that one-on-one interaction with people that come into, like, God doesn't do things willy-nilly. Amen?
Amen.
There's a reason why people come into our lives. There's a reason why we, you know, meet people at the stores and things like that. It's because God wants to give us an opportunity to be strong, to be brave, to be bold. He will give us the words to bless people. He will give us those words. Sometimes we hold back because we're like, oh, I wanted to say something, but if we just trust in him, that is the main thing. We need to have trust. We need to trust. We need to have faith that God can talk to us as we're talking to somebody, to just let them know, him or her, to let them know that God loves them. And then we can have that conversation with them. Amen? So, as I said, it can be a relative, it can be a brother, it can be a sister who you know are not dedicating themselves to the gospel. Amen? It could be a cousin. It could be a long-time person who you haven't, relative that you haven't spoken to in a long time. Amen? Or it can be someone, as I said, that calls you weekly, but you still haven't connected in that way, that just tell them that God is awesome, that God is beautiful. Amen? And so these are the things that when I say real difference, that's what I mean by real difference. That we can show them, prove to them that God is an awesome God. We have, as we did last week, we have, and it was brilliant, but we have our testimony. Amen? We have a way that we can describe how God has been good to us, each and every one of us. And so, again, we see in this illustration, Philip was with the multitude. He was one of those that God had honored, the people had said, hey, this is a leader. But I truly believe that you guys are all leaders. I believe that. I believe that you're all leaders because I know that you have, as I said, relationships outside of this place that you can think about and think, oh, you know what? I should be able to talk to that friend. I should be able to talk to that person. In my work, I've had the honor of having 3 people through conversation now go to church. Amen? 3 people that I know have changed their ways and have been baptized and go to church. One of them, Sister Gail, goes to Bible Way. I don't think you saw her when we were there. But if you remember the couple that had the senators on and they were on stage,
yes,
right? Those individuals were a correlation from Sister Gail. So again, I spoke to Sister Gail at work, told her about, you know, God, told her to come to Bible Way. She's remained, it's been, I think, 3 years, if I'm correct. But in that relationship, then she had a relationship with that couple, and now they're going to church. And I think they, you know, and they testified that there, it's been, Bible Way's been a blessing for them because of their daughter going to the school that they would, you know, like all these things. As I said, God just has a way, right, that he can make those connections. Now their daughter goes to the school that's in the church. So it just continues, as we talked about earlier, multiply, multiply, multiply. But it's not always going to be, we talk to a general audience. We can multiply by our one-on-one interactions. One-on-one interactions with those that we know and that we love. Because we are about love. Amen?
Amen.
We're about love, and so we're supposed to share that. We're supposed to share that love to others. Amen? That's what it's about. And so, as I said, just to wrap it up, is that Philip was with the multitude. And then God spoke to him to have that one-on-one relationship with this eunuch, with this man from Ethiopia, with this person who, you know, wasn't a Jew, you know, wasn't a Grecian, just someone that was just before him. The opportunity was there, and the blessing is that he believed in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and that he got baptized. Amen? Let's stand. And the last scripture that I'll share is the last two verses. I was at 38, so at 39 and 40. It says, "And when they were come out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more. And he went on his way rejoicing," meaning the eunuch was happy, rejoicing, because he had now been baptized. "But Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea." In other words, I bring this to your attention because it wasn't just, oh, I got one, and that's it. You know, he wasn't looking and saying, okay, you know, Philip's there, okay, I'm done, I can go back home. No, he continued the journey, meaning that we need to continue our journey. Amen? Because that I can, you know, speak about Brent, I can speak about Gail, but I don't want to stop short there. You know, if I have an opportunity to speak to anybody, I think I told you maybe a week back, you know, I was at a reunion, and 2 out of the 10 or 11 people that were there, I know, go to church as a result of me being in contact with them. But it was like I kept on looking at them and just going, I would love to see Sarah, I would love to see Nina, I would love to see Howie at church. Amen? And so, for my mind, it says, I need to continue. Amen? And so I'm just encouraging you. Just as Philip did, he didn't stop there. He continued on and was looking for more to be touched by God. Amen? Let's pray. Let's bow our heads. Hallelujah. Lord Almighty God, I pray that it was an effective word today, Almighty God. Hallelujah. Lord Almighty God, I pray, Lord, that they've heard a word that they can understand. Hallelujah, that Lord Almighty God, each and every one of us are ministers. Each and every one of us are disciples. Each and every one of us are apostles. We, O Lord God, hallelujah, need to have that wisdom and understanding that we can touch lives, Lord, that we can bless lives, O Lord God. Whoever we come into contact with, O Lord God, whether young or whether old, we have that connectability, Almighty God. I pray, Lord, that the word, O Lord God, would be, again, an appetite, O Lord God, that they can receive, O Lord God, and digest, Lord. Have wisdom and understanding that each and every one of us are powerful because you are powerful. That, Lord, you can bless us, O Lord God, with the words that we need, O Lord God, to say to those, O Lord God, that would be before us, O Mighty God. Give us that encouragement. Give us that strength that we need, O Mighty God. Give us that wisdom, O Lord God, to bless others, O Lord God. Hallelujah. The Lord this walk is not just about us, but it's about, Lord God, the multitudes that are lost out there, Almighty God. And that we can do it, Almighty God, by honoring you, Almighty God, by Lord, Almighty God, coming to a place of wisdom, Almighty God. Open our eyes to see, Lord, what we can do, Almighty God. That, Lord, Almighty God, I pray that this is a word that has been received. Make a real difference in someone's life, O Lord God. Let us trust you, Almighty God, that we can do that. We all have faith, O Lord God. Let us believe in this word, O Lord God. We can make a difference, Almighty God. Even those that are outside in this craft, O Lord God, area, this market, O Lord God. Hallelujah. Let us have that one conversation with that one person, Almighty God, to invite them to church, Lord. It all starts there. Let us, O Lord God, lean upon you for wisdom and understanding, Almighty God, of what we need to do, Almighty God, and to do your work, your will, not ours, your will, not ours. We give you thanks in Jesus' name, Almighty God. And everybody says,
Amen.
Holy, 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 holy. Holy, 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 holy. Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
It's so holy.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You are worthy.
It's so worthy.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord's Prayer. Yep. Hug and love one another in Jesus' name.
Amen.